Hello, and welcome to the weekly teaching of Catalina Church North in Tucson, Arizona. You're joining us for our series titled Love Story. Here we're going to take an in-depth look at what it means to be truly and deeply in love with the Creator of heaven and earth. So let's join our speaker this week, our lead pastor, Ted Soderholm, and the message already in progress.
So we're talking about love, and we're going to talk about this story, this adventure story that you know, whether this is your first time to ever be in church. You have probably still heard of this story, but if you've heard this story 100 times in church, what you've not noticed was the ending. And so we are going to talk about the ending. If I were to ask you the greatest movie of all time, you would shout out the answer, and it would be Ratatouille, right? I think we can all agree that is incredible. And maybe the second one would be Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. And there's that moment in Butch Cassidy where they start saying this phrase over and over. Who are those guys? Who are these guys? They just keep tracking them. Our job is to go and shoot people and take money, and we're supposed to get away with that. And these guys are relentless, and they keep coming, and they're trying to figure out who the tracker must be and who are these guys. And at one point, they blow up the train. Use a little too much dynamite, and the Pinkerton gang come up behind him in a train. They can't get away from these guys. And so that figures into the end of this adventure we have with Jesus. But as you're sitting there, think about the moment where you were in the middle of an adventure that probably started with this phrase, sure, that sounds like fun. And then you get to that moment in the middle of the adventure where you have the thought, I could potentially die in the next couple of minutes. As I was thinking through those, I thought, I was stunned by the number that came to mind without really putting any thought into it at all. It turns out that we have lived a very adventurous, dangerous life, and most of it is entirely my own fault, my own choices that put me in those situations. My dad used to put us to bed. He was born in 1919. I am 49 years old. My dad was almost 50 when I was born. He was born in 1919. And so my brother and I shared a room back in New York, and he would read the Bible story and pray with us. And then my brother, who was a good kid, would fall asleep. And then me, a night owl, I would want more stories. And so he would tell me war stories and then stories of being a kid growing up, which worked out because later in life, as his memory was slipping, I could remind him of the details because he had told me those stories so many times. No, Dad, that actually isn't true. That what happened was, and he would say, oh, yeah, that sounds familiar. Well, it should sound familiar because it's your life. Not that you could remember. But he told me this one. He said it was back in the 1930s in New York, and he and some friends wondered, how fast would you have to drive to get that dotted white line to appear solid? What kind of free time you working with here, Dad, that this would be what you guys were thinking about, 1930 Depression era New York? So they thought they would try it. We're talking about a 1930s automobile. And so they started driving fast. They found a stretch of road where nobody was. I'm guessing the middle of the night. I'm not guessing everybody was sober. I'm just throwing that out there. That was not part of the story. And they started driving until they got to the point where the red or the white line appeared solid. Does anybody know what speed that is? Anybody want to shout out a guess to admit to your poor choices in the past? 45? 9,800. They found that based on 1930s speedometer, 95 miles an hour. So I'd like to stress, teenagers, you do not have to go try this. It is already an experiment that's been done. You don't have to do this. You don't have to fly a kite in the thunderstorm, right? These things have already been done. 95 miles an hour is where the line appears solid. And two things. One, I would hear that and I think, Dad, were you running gin? What is going on that you're going 95 miles an hour in a 1930s automobile, playing pretty fast and loose with my future? And the other thing is that made it really easy to tell my dad whenever I got one of my 13 speeding tickets that I accumulated before I got married. Do you know how easy it is to walk up to your dad? The first one, I was 18 years old, or 17, 16. I think I was 16, come to think of it. And I got a speeding ticket. And I had some friends that got speeding tickets, and they were terrified to go home and tell their dad. Not me. I walked in and said, hey, Dad, I got a ticket, slapped it down on the table. And he started to give me the, you know, speech. And I said, hey, Dad, look at the speed there. You know what you're going to notice? Less than 95 miles an hour. That's what you're going to notice right there. And I've never gotten a ticket for more than 95 miles an hour, so in my mind, I am clearly a step forward from my parents' generation. But as you think through the craziest adventures you've been in, where you really think, I could potentially not survive this. I find that true every day in the deserts, in the heat, right? We were down the Rita River for the last couple of weeks. It's actually been a river. That's been pretty exciting. So we have riverfront property. We're selling our house. I wish we had mentioned that in the job description. But we went down. We walked past five houses. We're at the river. We go down, and we were playing in the 50-degree mountain stream yesterday. And then one of our neighbors walked by. And so he said, Stacy, you seem to do this all the time. You walk down in the Rito River, you know, what do you call it, basin, dust bowl? I don't know what you call it. And I said, how often do you see a snake? And she said, well, of course, I'm not down here in the summertime. Well, no, because you'll die, right? But she said, in the spring, I see a lot of snakes. And I said, are they right here where we are standing? And she said, oh, no, they're way down there. And I said, now, when you say way down there, what are we talking about? She said, about 400 feet. Okay, good, because in my understanding, a snake can't travel 400 feet, so I think we're fine. And I said, what size is it? She said, well, it's, you know, I've seen some pretty big snakes. And she said, what I don't know is if there are four different snakes that I saw last spring or if it's just the same snake I saw over and over. She said, because I didn't get close enough to have any I don't know, how do you identify a specific rattlesnake, right? My name is Bob. He's got a little tag on him, right? The one that wears the loafers, that one. Any time that we're in the desert, I feel like we are potentially close to death. But you've had adventures in life where you realize either it was a choice you made or a choice somebody else made. I used to find New York City a remarkably comforting place because of my dad's old stories of his grandfather, who was a tailor in Brooklyn, and then the tales of his dad and my mom, who used to live in Mount Vernon and have all her adventures in the city. I found New York to be this family occasion kind of a place. But one time, it was about 1990, and I was wandering to meet a friend, and I don't know, somewhere in Manhattan, I don't remember where it was, and I came around a little corner, and I was walking, and all of a sudden, there was a gang fight going on, and there were being punches thrown, and there was a lot more blood than you'd want to see at 11 o'clock in the morning. And that was the first time it struck me, this might actually be a dangerous place. I didn't establish any eye contact with anybody. I just kept walking. In New York, if you act like you know what you're doing, people will pretty much let you do it. And so I just kept walking. But I was fairly shaken by the whole experience. And even though that's now almost 30 years ago, it still feels like it just happened this morning because it was that startling. So you have your examples, and I have mine. Maybe it was when the doctor came and brought you some news, and you realized mortality could be close. Those moments when we're just crushed by fear or the realization that this life is maybe more precious than I have given it credit for because it's about to come to an end potentially. Now, with that in mind, look at this. As evening came, Jesus said to his disciples, he's been in a boat talking, good acoustics, so he's in a boat talking, and there's a huge crowd because it's Jesus and he's talking. I mean, let's be honest, if Jesus shows up, we're handing him the mic, right? I mean, he's good. He's been telling all these stories and the parables, trying to explain how life really works, and he has the crowd mesmerized. Let's cross to the other side of the lake. It's about a five-mile trip. He's with some professional fisher people, among others of his disciples. And notice that this is a declarative sentence. It's a promise. Let's cross to the other side. Could be an adventure to get there, but we will get there. He doesn't say, hey, who wants to die in a storm, right? He doesn't say that. He says, let's cross to the other side. Life is an adventure. One of the things we get lost with God is we think God should be blessing our life, and mostly we want it smooth with choices of adventure, like going to Disneyland, right? That's when we want adventure. But on a regular occasion, life is much more adventurous than we would sign up for. The phone rings, we pick it up, we don't realize what's going to happen, and our whole life gets tumbled for a while. So we don't want to get lost in the middle. We don't want to lose hope. Hope is grounded in Jesus being who he said he is. So they took Jesus in the boat and started out, leaving the crowds behind on the shore. And notice this little parenthetical statement from Mark. Although other boats followed, So the four Gospels of Jesus, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and Matthew and John were eyewitnesses. They were there. Luke was a doctor who did the eyewitness accounts. A lot of Luke's early stuff and even middle stuff comes from Mary, Mother Mary. If you read through it, you see her perspective all throughout Luke and other eyewitnesses that Luke talked to. But Mark was there for the very end, but mostly Mark seems to have written down Peter's stories. So Peter would have been in the boat. This is not the time that Peter got out and walked on the water with Jesus, but Peter was a professional fisher guy. He knows a little something about boats. He knows that storms sometimes come up. And this is basically Peter's version. And remember that parenthetical statement, other boats followed. Verse 37, but soon a fierce storm came up. My dad in World War II was in the Mediterranean, and the Mediterranean can have fierce storms that kick up pretty quickly. And because it's not that shallow, it is fairly shallow, relatively speaking, they can, like sort of like the kids in the bathtub, we have a four-year-old, and if we leave her in the bathtub too long, she will start physics experiments with the water. And she will start racing to the other side of the tub, and in about three trips, she has this tidal wave that we're trying to sell the house, sweetheart, and you did a good job cleaning the floor, but that water damage is going to cost us. So the Mediterranean can be like that, and where they were can be like that. It's a big lake, but it's not that deep, and so the waves can kick up pretty fast. A fierce storm came up. Jonah got into the fierce storm, Jonah and the whale, by running from God. These guys are literally in the boat. They are following Jesus. Jesus said, let's go to the other side. They said, okay, and other boats are following. So running from God to get in the storm, following God to get in the storm, it might be that our goal to have a comfortable life might not be the option, avoiding the storm. High waves were breaking into the boat, and it began to fill with water. Now, I've never seen the Perfect Storm movie, right, from Marky Mark or whoever that was 25 years ago. But I did see Titanic twice, so I feel like I'm kind of an expert. And one time going to Nantucket Island, it was really windy, and we were all fairly seasick. So I speak as a bit of a boating expert. Sure, some of you may have slightly more experience, but I can say definitively that water in the boat risks the boat no longer doing its job, which is to keep you separate from the water. Can I get an amen? You want your boat, and you want your water, and you want those separate. And then there's this problem, one we often sense when trouble strikes us. Jesus was sleeping at the back of the boat with his head on a what? So professional fisher people are getting nervous because now there's water in the boat. And you've got Jesus, who is a bright idea to go to the other side. He was the one that just gave the great speech. It was so good that people are following him. He is so compelling that they are following Jesus. And in the middle of the storm, he's asleep. And I love that little detail with his head on a cushion. Comfortable, Jesus? Want a blanket? Want a drink of water? Would you get up, please? What's the old saying? A clear conscience is the best pillow. So Jesus not only had the clearest of conscience, but he also had the pillow. So he is comfortable. He has been working hard. So Jesus is fully God and fully human. And this is the human side. He's been working. He is tired. He is in the boat. He is out. And the waves are so high that they are crashing over their fishing vessel that holds, you know, a dozen people or so. It's a reasonably sized boat. And is being tossed around in the waves and doesn't bother Jesus at all. He's tired. So the disciples woke him up. What's that next word? Say it louder.
Shouting.
When sheer panic sets in. We have this, we've been married for almost, I think, as I do the math quickly, 18 years now. And we'll be driving along in our family minivan, and somebody, somewhere in the line of cars ahead of us, I'll be driving, Jenny will be in the passenger seat, somebody will have their brakes, and the lights will come on, the red lights. And Jenny, on occasion, will freak out. And she'll slam her brakes on, which don't actually exist. and her hands will fly out in front of her. And then she'll say something like, they're breaking, they're stopping. And I will say, because I'm New Yorker and think I'm funny, I will say, I do see that they're stopping. And honey, I would like to apologize one more time for earlier in our marriage when I thought it was funny to just crash into the back of cars and not stop. When have I ever not stopped? I have a self-preservation angle going on. As the dad, I feel very responsible for the children in the car. I'm not going to crash into somebody because we're going 38 miles an hour because all the snowbirds are here and we can't speed anymore. We're doing 38 and a 45, and somebody in the lineup of cars has tapped their brakes. Frankly, I'm celebrating we have any forward motion going on at all. There are those moments in life where you just lose your cool and you start shouting. These are professional fisher people. They're in the boat. Peter's telling the story. His whole job was to fish. He's been in a boat. He's been in a boat in a storm. And Jesus is laying there in the storm. And so they start shouting, hey, teacher, rabbi. They were following him because he was a rabbi. And the highest calling in their culture was if the rabbi would call you to follow, was the implication that he saw in you the ability to you yourself perhaps one day graduate and be a rabbi. Not everybody who followed became a rabbi, but that's the only process to become a rabbi is you have to follow a rabbi. And so Jesus had called them, and so they followed. So rabbi or teacher, don't you care that we are going to drown? I've been woken up poorly many times. I have small children who will just start climbing into bed with me talking about ghosts. I don't want you or the ghosts. What is happening? I am sound asleep. It's been about a year that this was pretty horrific. The three-year-old came in to my side of the bed. Do we not remember where mommy's side of the bed is? Came to my side of the bed, started crawling in with me to bed. And I said, what's wrong? And she said, I wet my pants. Well, a couple things. How about you just stand beside the bed and tell me? So we have to do a bath in the 3 o'clock in the morning. I have seen 3 o'clock in the morning more as a parent than I ever did as a single guy. There are just those moments. And notice what they said. We are going to drown. If you're going to wake up Jesus by shouting in his face, I think, you could rub his back a little bit, right? My brother, to watch Sunday at Saturday morning cartoons, would open up my eye till it dried out, right? That's an effective way I have found to wake somebody up. We don't have teenagers trying to get them up for school yet, but we will find there's effective ways. You can throw cold water on them, I'm told. I don't think that's recommended, but it's a desert. It would dry by nighttime, right? Just do it again tomorrow. But to shout in somebody's face, don't you care, I think is a terrible way to wake up. And notice they said we. You know what they're implying? Hey, Jesus, if this boat goes down, you and your bathrobe aren't swimming away either, right? We, don't you care? Isn't that where we find ourselves with God when something bad is happening? God, don't you care? Well, the assumption is that we have a full grasp of the situation. We know not only where we are, but what has preceded it, and we didn't miss any of it, and what is yet to come. And so this is what's important, and this is what needs to change. And if God is really God, he will care about what we care about. That's where surrender and trust comes in, because God is working on a different level than we are that we don't often know about. So don't you care that we're going to drown, you too, pal. And Jesus, when Jesus woke up, when? That kind of implies it took a while, right? We were shouting in his face for like 10 minutes. Jesus, the sound sleeper. When Jesus woke up, he rebuked the wind. Rebuked. He rebuked the wind and said to the waves, silence, be still. As a parent, I've tried this with very little effect. But it's just fun being Jesus. Jesus could have called ahead and said, hey, let's just make the trip really smooth, shall we? But instead, there's the storm. Satan could have caused the storm. God could have caused the storm. It doesn't say. Weather patterns could have caused the storm. Storms happen. And Jesus is asleep. They shout in his face, "Don't you care that we're going to drown?" So he gets up, "Silence, be still." Suddenly the wind stopped and there was great calm. They have their culture and we have our culture. And one of the things that they did that we don't do is they used to acknowledge spiritual things, which we don't much. We acknowledge physical things. And we're making progress with recognizing emotional things. If you got some emotional stuff, go on to the webpage that they talked about, CatalinaNorth.org, and go to the give page. Well, you think, well, why would we ever do that? Go to the give page and scroll down, and there's a lady's name, Deb Hayes. Deb, professional counselor. She is a Christian who is a counselor. And you click on that, and it'll send her to send you to her information, and call her office and schedule. You know who's going to pay for that visit? We are. Because we believe that it is really helpful to have someone trained in the world of helping us be healthy emotionally. So physical we recognize and emotional we recognize. You know what we're recognizing more than I think, maybe I just wasn't paying attention, I'm 49 years old. We recognize political. I have friends that don't talk to each other anymore based on who somebody voted for. You don't know either person. You don't know if either one is going to be a complete disaster or work out. I have faith in the system. It is such an incredible bureaucracy. How much damage can you do, really? Try to accomplish something in the system. Now is where the frustration kicks in. But I have friends who won't talk to each other because of based on who they voted for. I voted, but I didn't vote for anybody. You know who I was excited about? Ben Carson. That shows what I know, right? I heard a Ben Carson interview. I was all excited about that guy. Like a week later, he wasn't even in the polls anymore. Now he's in charge of HUD. Wouldn't he be better as the Surgeon General? I don't know. Every 4 years, they ask my opinion, I give it, and then I sit quietly to see what happens. You know what I have to do every year? Pay taxes. That's what bothers me a lot more than who's in office, I can tell you. Although I am, you know, kind of excited about police, fire, and roads, so I don't complain that much. We give a little credit to physical, to mental, emotional, to political, but what they gave credit to that we really don't acknowledge much is the spiritual. Rebuked the waves. What's the old phrase about shouting into the darkness? It doesn't do any good. Jesus rebukes the darkness and it becomes light. Rebuked. Like there's something going wrong. When you rebuke somebody, you're pointing out you're doing it wrong. It needs to be different. He rebuked the waves. Are waves in trouble because the wind is kicking them up? It's the same phrase, the same terminology when Jesus rebuked, silenced the demons that comes right after this. It's the same word. They're demon waves? Well, not quite. But there is a spiritual element of what's going on that we discount. So that implies that maybe Satan was trying to wipe out the boat. A little short-sighted, but hey, let's just drown them all and we'll move on. This was a spiritual battle more than a weather crisis. And we get that in just a sentence or so. Remember, there were other boats that followed. Jesus didn't just save himself. He didn't just save the followers in the boat who were about to take on the world when he was gone. But there were other boats and there were other people who wanted to follow Jesus wherever he was going. Verse 40, Jesus asked the people in his boat, the ones who were just shouting in his face, "Don't you care that we are going to drown?" And then Jesus rebukes the waves, it gets calm, and then he asked, "Why are you afraid?" Which is still a good question for us. Because if you're paying attention to the world, you're afraid of something. If you were to sit down with lunch, the two of us, and you were honest, you would give me a list of what you were afraid of, and I would give you a list. I think I'm most afraid of what's going to happen to my children. They really should come with a warning sticker that you are just going to live in panic for the rest of your life. I was fine to live in Midtown with my wife. I'd walk the dog. And back then when we could afford it, right, we had the police helicopters looking for somebody. Never bothered me. I was fine. But the day we brought our oldest home from the hospital and there was gang tagging on the inside of our wall, I said to my wife, hey, guess what? We're moving to the suburbs. I've never lived there before, but I'm going to love it. And now we live where crime is illegal, which is a lot different than Midtown. And we're moving to Oral Valley, where crime is illegal. I don't think they even have police officers up there anymore, right? It's self-policed. Just the old people doing this. Hey. People have told me if you speed in Oral Valley, you get a speeding ticket. You know what I found? I've yet to get a speeding ticket, but I've gotten this a few times. Very effective. Thank you, Grandma. Somebody's grandma. The shame kicks in. I'm sorry. I don't know what I'm doing. Pointing to the children's seat in the back. You, young man, of all people. Just the fact that you called me young man made me thrilled. I listened to every word she had to say. But what we're dealing with is, why are you afraid? I've got my reasons I'm afraid. You have your reasons you're afraid. But if we genuinely trust that the God of the universe is at work, and this isn't all there is, this is, what did Shakespeare say? It's a stage. This is stage one. He was talking about stage like Spotlight, but it really is stage one. It's where we're practicing. It's where we're figuring some things out, but we continue on throughout eternity. And it's not floating on a cloud eternity. It's there's things to do eternity. It's going to be incredible. Yeah, I agree with the kid. It's going to be outstanding. And yet we get afraid here because this is what we know, and it's easier to cling to what we know than what we have sort of imagined. Our now 8-year-old doesn't ask anymore because we put some work into it. But on occasion, he would say, hey, Daddy, I'm afraid of heaven. Why are you afraid of heaven? Well, because I can't imagine what it's going to be like. It sounds too big. It's scary. And it's different. So we read the Bible and we read some books and we talked about it. And now he's excited about heaven. But it was a process to get there. I understand why we would be afraid of something different. So when we ask why are you afraid? Well, if we actually believe Jesus is who he says he is, we shouldn't be afraid. But the thing is, we sort of believe Jesus is who he says he is. These guys were in the boat with him. And Jesus said, do you still have no faith? So Jesus, who you've just shouted in his face to get him to wake up, has silenced the waves, and the storm that you were terrified about is now gone. And then he says to you, why are you afraid? Do you have no faith? We didn't. But then you did that. I mean, the speech was really good, but stilling the waves, wow, that's really impressive. When I lived in London, they asked me in Kansas City to move to London, and I agreed with them that that was probably the best way to go. I was in minister training school, getting my Master's of Divinity degree, and they thought that I was a bad fit in Kansas City. So in London, I met some people. And the story in London, most people going to church, they were in their 20s. They had only recently become Christians. And so one of the people in the church had a sister. And the sister and her boyfriend were professional musicians. They would fill in on the London, Broadway of London. And so I would get free tickets all the time because nobody else wanted to go to musicals. And deep down, I love musicals. I'm happy to go. And if it's free, I'm even happier. So when they would get the free tickets, I would go. And they were filling in all the time. And so we were talking one time. They were about ready to fill in at one of the, I don't know which one it was. And they were handing me the tickets. And we were having some food first in the musician's snack lounge. And they weren't Christians. But they were fascinated that I seemed reasonably normal and yet was a Christian. And so we were talking about this. It's been an ongoing conversation for a couple of months. And so the sister said, hey, Ted, last night I had a dream and I think I'm starting to get this whole God thing. And if you're a minister, those kinds of things, they can be a setup. It made me a little nervous. And I said, okay, well, tell me about your dream, which isn't something we usually say in America. And she said, so we were hiking up in Scotland. And there was this place where you look down on the narrow roads. I've never been, but those of you who've been to Scotland, they have those roads that are basically one lane with turnoffs periodically. And so she and the boyfriend were hiking, and they were looking down on this road, and they saw the lorry truck, the delivery truck, going this way, and they saw a farmer and his car coming this way, and they realized that the farmer doesn't realize this, but from their perspective, they can see that the farmer should just stop right there, because the lorry truck's about to come around the corner. It's going to be a close call, and then the farmer is going to have to back up to that turnoff that he just passed. And that's exactly what happened. The farmer and the lorry come screeching to a stop. The farmer backs up on this windy road. He has to wait. The lorry driver goes by, and then the farmer can continue on his way. And she said, so we were talking about that, and then I fell asleep, and she said, my dream was I felt like the God of the universe was saying, that's how I see you. I see where you've been. I see where you are. I see what's coming, and I'm asking for you to trust me. Well, that's pretty good, actually. Huh. Why are you afraid? Well, because we don't actually believe that you're God. And if we do, C.S. Lewis, English guy, became a Christian reluctantly, he said, I think our biggest complaint with God isn't just surrendering that, God, you know what you're doing. I think our biggest complaint is, God, how much is this going to be painful for me to become who you want me to be? Because there's what I want to do, and then if I follow you, I'm afraid I'm going to have to give up all the fun. And we miss that the fun gets replaced by a joy that is endless. And we can still have fun. If Jason wants to catapult himself off a very expensive mountain bike while being chased by Lance Armstrong, he can do that. And then he will come back, and we as his church family will give him a hug and make fun of him at all costs. We can still have the fun. But our concern is, God, if you're not blessing my life, that means I have to join into what you are doing, and I'm concerned how difficult that is going to be. Jesus said, do you still have no faith? Verse 41, the disciples were absolutely what? Terrified. So they were afraid of the storm. Now that the storm has gone away, now they're really afraid. Can we just have the storm back and you go back to sleep? Because I think we can make it through that. But if you're actually God, now the question is, what do I have to do? If you actually are God, what do I have to do? If Jesus is who he says he is, and we have to follow, what if it takes us where we don't want to go? And then they asked the line from Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, who is this guy? Who is this man, they asked each other. Even the wind and waves obey him. Those words we don't like, trust and fear. We're going to do communion. We did it last week. We're going to do it again this week because it fits in perfectly. So as Steve and Gina and the gang get up and pass out the communion cups, they will send it down the aisle. Take one if you'd like to participate. But as Jesus was asking the question, why are you afraid? Do you still have no faith? And Peter's very honest response was, frankly, we were more terrified by Jesus that moment than we were by the storm. Who is this guy? The question of, thanks, John, of who is this guy is our question. Because we can get lost in the storm. You've got stuff going on in your life right now that if you're not terrified, I'm questioning if you're paying attention. I love to read old biographies, and one of my favorites that I read last year was the Wright brothers. Orville and Wilbur, their thick book that came out last year, and all their adventures to get the plane in the air. But you know what got them excited? Their dad, who was a minister, was on travels. He was a bishop, and he was traveling, and he wanted a toy for his kids, and not just a silly toy, but an adventure kind of a toy. And he got them this toy that flew. It's this spinning thing that you spin it in your hands and it takes off and it goes up in the air. And the guy who invented that in his 20s lived in France. I think he lived in Paris. And so he was excited that he invented the toy and that people wanted to buy it. Good. But you know what he really wanted to do? He wanted to fly himself. He wanted to have the airplane. He wanted to invent flight. But he, even though he could get the toy to fly and he could get people to buy the toy, he got it shipped all the way to America where people bought it. The toy made him a success. What he really wanted was for people to fund his, invest in his idea that we could create the airplane and that humans could fly. But the airplane was in, the Wright brothers were 1903. Now you knock off 20-some years back when they were kids. You see the guy's problem. We're talking about the mid-late 1800s, and nobody really thought that people could fly. Oh, people were trying, but it wasn't ending well. And the inventor of the toy that inspired the Wright brothers was so disappointed that he couldn't get people to invest in his dream, his idea that we could fly, he ended up taking his own life when he was 30 years old. When all he had to do was trust that God is at work, I've been given gifts, I've been giving this, been given this unique opportunity. I've created the toy that shows that flight is possible. We can create things that fly. It's not just birds. And he didn't have to wait that many more years. It would have been his lifetime, a natural span of life. And he would have seen the guys that he inspired fly. Don't you think they would have happily given him a trip? It is where we find ourselves. We feel like the waves are crashing over us. We can see how this could end poorly. And the God of the universe asks, why are you afraid? Because the book ends with God wins. And those of us who want to be a part of that get to win as part of the family. If you're a member of good standing in the family, is doing well financially, you win. If you're a member of good standing and the family gets invited someplace fun, you get to go, you win. We get to be part of the family of God. And if you have a little more success getting this top off than I am, oh, there it goes. We start with the wafer. Jesus was sitting around with the same friends that he was in the boat with. And they've seen him do the miracles. They were there when he calmed the storm. They were there when Peter walked on water for a step and a half. They were there when he chased out the demons. They were there when he faced up to the ministers of the day that were pretty intimidating and didn't like them. And they were there the night that Jesus, they thought they were celebrating Passover, the Jewish festival of Passover. They were slaves in Egypt. In order to get the Egyptian Pharaoh, the guy that Moses had grown up with, his attention, God killed the firstborn. Every one of the plagues, Pharaoh's magicians were able to reproduce as if it was just a battle of the gods. And God said, no, that was just your opportunity. Frogs are funny. Flies are annoying. It just got serious. And so he killed the firstborn of everybody in Egypt, but not of those in the family of God. The angel of death passed over. And so at their best, they would celebrate the fact that God is God, and there is evil in the world, but God wins. And they were sitting down to do Passover, and Jesus took the bread and he broke it, and he said, we're going to change this up a little bit, because God can change the festival. And Jesus said, this is my body that is broken for you. Eat all of it. And they were coming from a sacrifice culture. We don't really sacrifice anything. We considering trimming cable to be a sacrifice. We don't understand sacrifice. We make the marriage vows till death do us part, or until my feelings start to wane a little bit and I think there's a better option. We don't say that second part out loud, but we don't value sacrifice. We go back not many years for most of us, not many generations. I'm a third generation American. And you see the challenges that people went through, the lives they gave up, what they knew to come to the new country and the promise of better, and the sacrifice that they had so that their kids could have a better life, and then the sacrifice so that their kids could have a better life. And here we find ourselves. We don't really live off the idea of sacrifice. We live off the idea of, hey, I did what I could. But Jesus grew up in a sacrifice culture. And his followers grew up in a sacrifice culture to the level that you'd come to church And there were whole ceremonies around forgiveness. Those things that we do that weigh us down. And you could bring your lamb as an agricultural society. If you were poor, you could bring a dove. If you ever tried to sleep with a dove outside your window, you're thinking, you know what, we could bring that back. Coo, coo, shut up. We've got it on video, our now four-year-old yelling, "Kiet, bird!" Because her dolly was trying to sleep and the bird was being loud. But you bring the dove, you'd bring the goat, you'd bring the sheep, you'd bring the lamb, you'd bring what you had, and you would kill it. You would confess your sins over it and then kill it, and you would see a couple of things. One, that sin has consequences, and two, the sacrifice that sin cost the animal its life. There's a weight to sin. But now that the debt has been paid, we now can be free. And we can live up to who God created us to be. And so Jesus had taken that many thousand-year-old sacrifice system and in one act said, we're not going to kill the animals anymore. They're going to kill me so that you guys can go on. He's going to fall on the grenade for us. And Jesus said, that sin that you've got that you can't imagine being forgiven, put it on the tip of your tongue. Confess it to the God of the universe. And this is the blood of Jesus to wash it away. Jesus said, this is my blood. Drink all of it. I'm going to pray. And then we're going to stand and we're going to sing loud the greatest song of all time, Amazing Grace. Would you please pray with me?
Hello again, and thanks for joining us online. We're always excited for you to be a part. If you're ever in our area, please stop by on Sunday mornings at 10:15. For more details about our services, beliefs, and what's going on at church, make sure to check out our website at catalinanorth.org. We hope to see you soon. God bless.